Well, good morning. It's great to see you out today. How about that rain this morning, huh? Thunderstorm, a little lightning. That was awesome. It's a great way. I think it scared a few folks off today, all right? They're staying home because of the slick roads, all right? But that's all right. That's all right. They'll be back. Actually, there's a rumor that some of them are staying home because the Raiders are playing today. Actually, what I expect is a bumper crowd at the 1045 because the Raiders are playing today, all right? Everybody will come out, yeah, for the last one. But anyway, it's great to have you here. If you are our guest at New Hope for the very first time, thank you so much for coming. In the pew in front of you, there are guest cards or connect cards. We would love for you to take one out, fill it out when it comes by, and let us know you were here. We promise not to irritate you or annoy you, but we'll send you some information through the mail. We hope we'll answer most of your questions. If you are a regular tender here, but in the last month you have not filled out one of these cards, we would love for you to do that. We're updating all of our information. We're sending out a free gift to everybody through email. How many of you have gotten yours already? Okay, good, good. How many of you starting to enjoy it already? Okay, good, good. How many of you can't get yours to open? We had that in the 8 o'clock service. I said, then call somebody smarter than me. Okay? No, it's pretty easy, but you can call Teddy, call the office, we'll try to walk you through it, or send an email back, all right, to them, and they will help you get through that. So please give us your current information. And some of you are saying, Tim, I just did that last year. Would you do it again, all right? Would you do it again? And here's why. Sometimes we don't put in the right information you put on here. Sometimes a 6 and an 8 get transposed, all right? And so this gives us a chance to make corrections even when they've been our errors, all right? Thank you. We had 32 or 33 people go on the Urban Plunge Friday night and Saturday. And the Urban Plunge was at the rescue mission. They spent the night there. If you are in this service and you did the plunge, would you stand, all right? Would you stand? All right, look at that. Okay. Remain standing just a moment. What's the matter with you people? Nobody on this side stood. All right, way to go, guys. Anybody? Carrie, stand back up. Quick, 30-second soundbite. How was it?
It was really awesome. We learned a lot about the homeless.
Okay.
And what they're all about and what kind of people are homeless right now.
Okay. And did it break some stereotypes you had? Okay. And it made you more comfortable to reach out? Okay, and we'll learn some things out of our own homeless outreach that we might do differently. Okay, great. All right, we'll do it again. All right, we will do another plunge down there. All right, so that was exciting to hear from them. Last Sunday, we had a special guest with us. His name was Roy. He was from Hawaii. Wasn't he good? Absolutely awesome. I got to tell you, I was a little jealous. He's tall, dark, and handsome. I'm short, pasty, and not, okay? And wow, but man, what a great story. And I shared with you last week that I didn't have any idea how I was going to handle it. I didn't even know I was going to handle something. But what they have done with ministry to the children of incarcerated parents, they've taken Angel Tree that we do at Christmas and we'll be engaged in just another 5 or 6 weeks. They've taken that to another level, and they have camps for these kids in the summer. And the life transformation that is taking place in these families, because instead of it just being a once-a-year thing, by the time you do a couple of events with them and they come to know Christ and they start to plug into a local church, you see families transformed, and it starts with the children. And so we're going to be in dialogue with them and PF on how can we get a camp started here in our area for these Angel Tree kids. And so in lieu of an offering last week, I ask you all to be in prayer. Now that you've heard his message and you've heard what he does, take a week, pray about it, and bring an offering back today. So if you brought an offering today, you put it in an envelope right on the outside of the envelope, Roy or Angel Tree Camp. Make the checks to New Hope if you write a check, but on the envelope, right, Roy, all of it's going to go there, and we'll keep you posted on how plans are developing there. The New Hope Marriage Retreat is coming up November 13th, 14th, and 15th. It's in Pacific Grove, and you can see Nick or somebody out at the pavilion for more information. They would be happy to get that information in your hands. We have two events coming up on October the 17th. One is our fall big shoot that's taking place up at Sun Mountain Gun Club, and there's flyers with informative information out on the table in the pavilion. If you plan on attending, this is an important flyer for you to pick up. also on October the 17th, is a private church-wide showing of a new movie release coming out that very day called Woodlawn. This is an entire family movie. Two previous movies we've talked about was kind of a chick flick. It was for the ladies. They all went. Actually, War Room was pretty awesome. All right, it was good. And so a lot of the women took us husbands to go see it, and it was good. I enjoyed it. This Woodlawn, this is a true story. This really happened. This is about a football team in the South during racial tension days. Black and white teammates, and revival broke out not only on the team, but in the school and in the city. And it's a powerful, powerful story. We showed you a clip last week. You can't beat the price. Tickets are available in the pavilion today. You have to get them here. You can't get them that day at the theater. $6. So this is for husbands and wives, men, women, take your kids. Great movie. We hope to fill up that theater, all right? That'll make everybody happy except the people right on the very front row, okay? But we'll have a great time that day. Let me update you on a few. We have a baby dedication in our next service. The Pittman family are going to be dedicating their new baby boy. His name is Paul, and so we're very excited about that. Let me highlight a few prayer requests, some that are just fresh this morning. Kelly Dillon continues to go through her physical therapy. Please continue to remember to pray for her. Joe and Mary Avila will be heading home from San Diego today. Their grandbaby, Emma Grace, that we shared last week, had some complications. And in fact, between the 9:15 and 10:45 service, things got worse. Okay? That's the bad news. The good news is, from that moment on, things got better. She didn't get to go home on Tuesday, but she did get to go home on Friday. I got a text this morning during the 8 o'clock service from them saying the last 2 days have been perfect. She eats on time, she burps on time, she poops on time, and she sleeps on time. So you can't ask for anything better than that. And so they're saying, please tell everybody thank you for your prayers. One of the tests showed that she does have a tiny hole in her heart. Probably will close up on its own. She'll see a cardiologist in about 4 weeks, sees the regular doctor tomorrow, but all is going very well and they're grateful. My cousin Debbie had a mini stroke about 10 days ago. She is home. Please pray for her recovery. Nancy Collins from our church, her sister Joan passed away this week. Would appreciate your prayers. Fran Reed, one of our seniors in our church, not able to get out like she used to. She has very little space in her lungs, and so she's on oxygen at home. She lives at home. She lives alone. Both of her husbands, she was married twice, both of them deceased. One child deceased. Parents gone. Wonderful, wonderful lady. Had a chance to get well acquainted with her this week. So please be praying for Fran Reed. Julia Edwards, a woman who's been in a care facility for a few years, so we've not been able to see her here at church. Went into Nancy Hines Hospice Care this week and launched from there to heaven. And please be praying for her daughter. Service will be here this coming Friday. And then I just found out that one of our small groups, Dorothy Levinson, just went in under hospice care. So please be remembering her. Lenny from our church had surgery this week. He's home doing well, but found out his wife tore everything in her right knee except her ACL. So the ACL is holding it together. Everything else has been torn. So she's going to have surgery scheduled soon. And then Brandy Walker, a granddaughter and niece of two of the ladies in our 8 o'clock service, has a tumor behind her eye, and the optical nerve is all intertwined around it. It's a very delicate situation. They will know more after tomorrow, and so would appreciate us remembering to pray for their family. So those are the updates that I wanted to share with you. This time I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. Gentlemen, would you come, please? And would you join with me as we pray? Our Father, I love you, and I thank you for the wonderful privilege of being here today with our church family and friends. I trust you with their needs. I have no idea what their week has been like, but Father, you do, and you care. And Father, because you care, we should care also. And so as we visit in the aisles and as we chat under the pavilion, as we ask that question, how are you? May we really care to listen. And when they answer, may we really care to pray, to join with them together and trusting you for your strength when we're going through seasons of weakness, that we can trust you for joy when our life seems to be filled with despair, that we can trust you for the hope that we need when life seems rough and rocky and there seems to be no end to the trouble of this world. And so, Father, I pray that we will become people more and more who care, who show compassion, who invest interest in each other. And so thank you, Father, for bringing us together today. Most important of all, may we turn our cares over to you today. And when we walk out of here, may we not take them back, but leave them with you, resting in your promises that you're big enough for the tasks in life that we face. Father, thank you for the privilege of giving today, sharing with you out of what you have so graciously given to us. Instead of saying, wow, I wished I had more, or I'm grateful I don't have less, saying, thank you, Father, that sometimes in spite of my own foolishness, I'm here, and I give to you testimony that you're big enough for what seems to be my failures. Thank you. May our hearts and minds be attentive to your word today, and most important of all, may our wills be submissive to your leadership. It's called obedience, something that we don't like a lot in our society today. But Father, may we trust and obey you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Stuart Hamlin, the one who wrote that song, I don't know how many of you know the story. He was a bit of an actor, okay? Acted a bit, sang a lot, was also a drunk till God saved him. And what a transformation took place in his life. And he wrote a couple of really, really good songs. And that was one of them. I invite you just to be prepared for a little bit in the sermon if you want to turn to 1 Samuel chapter 16. 1 Samuel chapter 16. In a few minutes, we'll get there. What we're doing today is we're going to start the first sermon of a three-week series because we're kicking off this week church-wide small group study. If you were part of a small group, all 20-plus of our hope groups throughout the church are going to start this study this week. We do this once or twice a year where, as a church, we kind of study the same thing, so we got common things to talk about. And so I'm very, very excited about the study that Teddy and Corey chose for us to do church-wide. So that those of you who are not in a hope group, I did not want you to feel left out on all the discussions. So we're going to preach about it every single Sunday, the same three things they'll be talking about that week. And I also didn't want those who are in hope groups to feel superior than everybody else. So I thought I would preach on the subject, exploring an Andy Stanley study. Try to say Andy Stanley study real fast. In the 8 o'clock service, I said, Andy Stanley Studley. He's a great preacher and a pastor, but he's really not a stud, all right? He's tall, he's thin, he's good looking, all right? But terrific guy. And he's done a study called The Comparison Trap. And I've gone through that study for the last couple of weeks, and I am here to tell you, this study that they're going to be in the next 3 weeks, it is better than any other study we have ever done before. This study is better, it is meatier, it is more interesting-er than anything that you have ever studied before. You know what I just did? I fell in the trap. I compared this study to other studies. Have you ever got caught in the traps of comparison? Dan just got back from fishing, getting ready to go again. I know most fishermen, I don't know if this is true about Dan, but I know what's true of most fishermen. Do not be the first fisherman to tell how big your fish was, because you lose every single time. The fish gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Bill and I caught a marlin one time, all right, when we went to Mexico. It's 14 feet long now, all right? It grew 7 feet after we caught it, all right? Because we turned it loose, okay? That was 5 years ago, so I'm sure it's 14 feet now. Only 7 feet when we caught it. So here's a question I have for you. Do you live in the neighborhood of Ur? I'm not talking about Ur the Chaldeans. That's what's currently known as present-day Iraq. It is where Abraham lived when God placed a call on his life and he said, I want you to leave Ur and I want you to go to a land of promise that I have prepared for you. Now, the Ur of the Bible is spelled U-R. The neighborhood I'm talking about today is spelled E-R. But I believe that what God said to Abraham thousands of years ago, he will say to you and me today, you need to leave Ur, and you need to move into the place of promise that I have prepared for you. Some of you might be asking, Tim, I'm so confused. What is this neighborhood of Ur you're talking? How would I know if I even live close to the neighborhood of Ur? Let me ask you a few questions, and your own answers will help you figure it out. Do you feel better when you compel yourself to others? Do you feel worser? I'm glad my mother's not here. When you compare yourself to others, do you always want a bigger Ur? What I mean by that is, do you want to be richer than? Do you want to be smarter than? Do you want to be taller, prettier, happier, skinnier, hipper than? Just put a name to it. Let's bring this inside the doors of the church. Do you look around and say, I want to be more spiritual or I want to be holier or I want to be more gifted or do you want more than me? Do you ever get excited when somebody with more than you lose something? I mean, have you ever had a friend who's had a great job? It's always been perfect for them and their life, their income, it always goes good. And one day you get a call and they say, oh, I need you to pray for me. I just lost my job. And over the phone you say, oh, I am so sorry. I'm going to pray for you. Because you just thought it's about time something went bad in their world. Because their was better than yours. Do you ever feel superior when others have less than you have? Do you consistently live looking to your left and looking to your right? Do that right now. Look left, look right. Do you consistently live looking to your left and to your right to discover where your is? Last question, this is a kicker. Have you ever gone into debt trying to be more than somebody else? We used to call this keeping up with the Joneses. And so we go into debt. Reminds me of something I read a long time ago. We buy things we don't need with money that we don't have to impress people we don't even like. Folks, that's a sure sign you live in Ur. Adam one day looked over at Eve. He said, do you love me, babe? And he said, yes, darling, I love you. And Adam said, no, Eve, I mean, do you really love me? And Eve said, yes, Adam, I do. And Adam said, no, honey, really and truly, with all your heart. And Eve looks to her left, and she looks to her right, and she says, Adam, who else? Who else? If somebody close to you didn't laugh, explain it to them after the service, okay? You see, something within each of us, something within each of us cries out, am I okay? Am I worth enough to me, to those that I love, to people who don't even know me, value me enough? We want to know whether we're good enough, whether we measure up, but what's the standard by which we gauge that from? Is it Speaking of Adam and Eve, by the way, someone has suggested that they had the ideal marriage, and here is why. He did not have to hear about all the men that she could have married, and she didn't have to hear about the way his mother cooked. See, a lot of people today battle inferiority complex. That's the feeling of not measuring up. It's the feeling of being less than others. It's the feeling that we're less than some ideal that we have put into our mind that we should be living up to. It's the idea that we're not living the privileges that we should have, that we're not getting the honors that we're supposed to receive. And so we keep looking. There was a woman who went to a psychologist for help, and she said, I have an inferiority complex. The doctor never takes the patient for her at their word, and so he put her through a battery of tests. She came back the following week, and the doctor said, "You, it's no complex. You really are inferior." Probably didn't stay in practice long. But the question is, have you said that to yourself? Have you felt that yourself? We often is in our life one way or another. Sometimes it's through situations and circumstances. Sometimes actually things that others have said. Sometimes it's things that we have heard in our own minds. But we look at the differences between one another, and here's the problem. Differences often become yardsticks by which we measure ourselves. We're not like the other coworker who's so much faster than I am. We are not as bright or as attractive or as athletic as our older brother or sister. Perhaps mom and dad weren't so subtle in the way they may have favored one child over another. Teachers have pets and I never was the one. They always pick somebody else to be on the team instead of us or me. And we come to believe that we're just not good at anything, not just kickball. We did not have as much as somebody else had. We did not get ahead as quickly. We did not get as far as other people. We did not make as much money. We weren't praised as much. We were more. We're not as intelligent. We are not as socially smooth as somebody. Maybe nobody has said it out loud, but we keep hearing a message in our brain that says, you are not good enough. You should be like, I will not be good enough until I am richer. I will not be good enough until I am better. I will not be good enough until I am whatever the blank is. There's a story in the Bible that gives us some insight into this kind of thought process. That's 1 Samuel chapter 16. Let's read the verses. Follow along with me if you would. I normally read out of a New International Version. My New International Version, my black Bible that was falling apart, it's getting a new cover. Our classic leather man around here is tooling one for me, and so he has my Bible. So I'm reading out of a new King James today. So if a few words are slightly different than yours, it's okay, all right? You're going to see that they mean the same. But jumping in, 1 Samuel 16, verse 1. Now the Lord said to Samuel, Samuel was God's prophet and judge at the time. And God said to Samuel, how long will you mourn for Saul, seeing I have rejected him from reigning over Israel? Saul is the first king of Israel. He was chosen because he stood head and shoulders above all the other men in the nation of Israel. God didn't choose him. Men chose him. Samuel anointed him, and Samuel is sad because this king is not choosing to follow God. Fill your horn, God says to Samuel, fill your horn with oil and go, for I'm sending you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I provided myself a king. It's always best for God to choose the king. I provided for myself a king among Jesse's sons. And Samuel said, how can I go? If Saul hears about it, he will kill me. If God says go, don't worry about the danger. If God says go, don't let fear stop you from going to where he sends you. He told Abraham, leave Ur, go somewhere you don't know yet, but I'll prepare it for you when you get there. He says to Samuel, go anoint a new king, but what if I lose my life? God says, don't worry about that part. I'm telling you, go. I'm wondering how many chose not to go on the urban plunge. There was something inside your spirit that said, yeah, this would be really good, but you know what? I don't want to hang out with those people. I've heard nothing from those who went, but I'll do it again in a heartbeat. I learned so much. My stereotypes were changed. God's going to send us in places that are not comfortable to us, but I am convinced that where he sends us is the most comfortable place we can be. And to resist where he sends us will make us uncomfortable in our old comfort zone. Let's read on. That's just a side sermon. But the Lord said, if you're afraid to go somewhere, take a cow with you. Take a heifer with you. And say, I've come to sacrifice to the Lord. You know, some people don't want to go to celebrate recovery. They even had a shirt made. Remember the first year Celebrate Recovery took place? We're one of those people, okay? You know what? Go to Celebrate Recovery. If you've got a hurt, habit, or hang up, go hang out there. If you're worried about it, take a cow. They will butcher it and barbecue it for you, all right? It'll be okay. They'll like you. Tell them at Jesse's house, I've come to sacrifice to the Lord. Then invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do. You shall anoint for me the one I name to you. So Samuel did what the Lord said, and he went to Bethlehem. And the elders of the town, trembling at his coming, said, do you come peaceably? And he said, peaceably, I've come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice. And then he consecrated Jesse and his sons, and he invited them to the sacrifice. So it was that when they came, that he looked at Eliab. And he said, surely the Lord's anointed is before me. This was Jesse's firstborn son, tall, good-looking dude. But the Lord said to Samuel, don't look at his appearance or his physical stature, because I've refused him. For the Lord does not see as man sees. For man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord, I, your Lord, I look at your heart. So when you and I are wanting more than somebody else, are we looking at their heart that we want more? Or are we looking at their wealth, their riches, their personality, their profession, their things, their stuff? I wonder if I walked out in the parking lot between services. I wonder how many license plates I might see that says, my grandkids are cuter than yours. So Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. That's the secondborn. And he said, neither has the Lord chosen this one. Then Jesse made Shammah pass by him. And he said, neither has the Lord chosen this one. Thus Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse, the Lord has not chosen these. And Samuel said to Jesse, are all the young men, are all of your sons here? And then he said, well, there remains one, the baby, the youngest. He's out keeping the sheep. And Samuel said to Jesse, send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes. So he went and he brought him in, and now he was ruddy. You know what ruddy means? Red-faced. He probably ran. So he's out of breath, okay? Bright eyes, good-looking for a kid. And the Lord says, arise, anoint this one. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. So Samuel arose and went to Ramah. David lived nearly 1,000 years before the birth of Christ. He was the youngest of eight sons born to Jesse, his father, and as a boy and a teenager, David's primary job was to care for sheep. When David was growing up, Saul was the king of Israel, but King Saul had become disobedient to God and displeased God so much that he decided to remove him as king. God then directed Samuel, the prophet, the spiritual leader of the time, go anoint a new king. And he sent him to Bethlehem. Accident? Where was the King of Kings born? Bethlehem. From the lineage of David, this shepherd boy that day had no idea when he was being chosen as the king of Israel that from his lineage would come Jesus Christ. This is written 1,000 years before it ever happens. God said one of Jesse's sons would be the next king. Samuel told Jesse that he was coming to his home to offer a sacrifice and worship, which would have been a great honor for Jesse. It would be like the Pope or Billy Graham coming to our house. So Jesse gathered all of his family, including his sons. As it turned out, he just brought most of his sons. He left one behind. So I'm sure Jesse must have thought, he won't be interested in my baby boy. I'm sure all the older brothers thought, nobody cares about David. Samuel was anxious for God to reveal which one of these sons would be the future king who would take the place of the failed king. So he had the sons come before him and he looked them over one at a time, kind of like cattle at an auction. And he was listening for the voice of God to identify the chosen one. Eliab, the oldest, stepped up first. And the Bible says Samuel looked at Eliab. That's significant because like many of us, Samuel was impressed by what he could see with his natural eye. He looked at him with physical eyes. And all he could see were the externals, his appearance. And he said, surely this is the one. He looks like keen material. He was no doubt tall and impressive and imposing physical appearance. We also know that Eliab was a military man because when David later visited the front lines during a battle with the Philistines and they were facing off against Goliath, Eliab was there on the front lines. But while Samuel looked at Eliab's appearance, he could not see his heart. He could not see his character. He could not see his thoughts or his attitudes. He did not see, for example, that Eliab was a rather negative, critical man. We get a glimpse of that when he's at the battle with the Philistines and with Goliath. Eliab, the soldier, severely criticized David, his little brother, for coming out onto the battlefield instead of being home tending the flock. By the way, side note again. Notice, after David is anointed king, where does he go? He goes back to the flock. He's anointed the next king of Israel. This is where we learned something from David that David learned early in his life that Joseph took several years to learn. Joseph had a dream that his older brothers would bow down to him someday. What'd Joseph go do? He ran and told his brothers, one of these days y'all are going to bow down to me. One of these days I'm going to be more importanter than you. One of these days I'm going to be more powerfuler than you. What does David do? He goes back and tends sheep. David had, in the very next paragraph in that chapter, Saul's heart is depressed and discouraged, and he says, go find me a harpist who will come play and soothe my troubled soul. Who do they find? David. David. David leaves the herd, and he goes to the king's house, the house that one day will be his home, and he's willing to play the role of a servant and soothe the king's soul. Does he try to take the throne then? No. Years pass and we're going to find out Saul becomes jealous of David and Saul tries to kill David. He's out in the field chasing David. David's hiding in a cave. Saul goes into a cave to pass a kidney stone and he has no idea that David's in that cave. And while he's doing his business, David cuts a corner of his robe off. And when Saul goes back outside, David steps outside and says, Saul, why are you trying to kill me? I'm not trying to take your job. God will give it to me in his time. I will not lay my hand on God's anointed. See, I could have taken your life, but I didn't. See, that's what God saw in the heart of David. Not the outward appearance, but a humble, submissive will for second fiddle, wherever God wanted him, at whatever time God wanted him. Then Samuel assumed that the chosen king would be the next brother or one of the others, but they all passed and God did not speak. However, God had specifically told Samuel, it's one of Jesse's sons. So believing God's words rather than just his eyes, Samuel asked a simple question. You got any more kids? You got any more hiding out somewhere? Yeah, I got one. He's the runt. Go get him. Bring him back. Imagine that. When it came to assembling his sons for the visit of the prophet of God, his father did not even think to include David. Should have had an inferiority complex, huh? Jesse saw his youngest as nothing more than the one who tended sheep, but there is the essence of David's heart, the person God chooses. It's the heart of a shepherd. David's heart was a humble heart, though relegated to tending sheep and out of sight, out of the limelight, but a task he fulfilled obediently and humbly. It's a picture of a surrendered self, not concerned for selfish glory or recognition, yet in a position where he could hear God's voice, God's plans, and God's purposes. Samuel and the others had to wait for David to show up to get there because David was not pushing to the front of the line, seeking the limelight. He was just doing his job tending sheep. And even after he was anointed, he went back to the flock. When Saul sent for him later, David was with the flock when he went to fight Goliath. His brothers criticized him for leaving the flock. But that shepherd heart was exactly what God was looking for. Somebody who would care for his people as gently and as wisely as a shepherd cares for the flock. That's a person after God's heart. David was not in the parade, this procession of sons passing in front of Samuel, but he was prominent in God's sight. And guess what? Every single one of you is prominent in God's sight. The scripture says that God is looking for any man or woman, for any boy or girl whose heart is turned towards him. Finally, David arrives. Unlike Saul, the first king, unlike Eliab and the older brothers, David was remarkably ruddy. But now Samuel understood God's standard of selection according to verse 7 of chapter 16. He said, don't consider appearance or height. Those are the things that men look at, but the Lord looks at the heart. While David was young, of average size, smaller than all of his other brothers, his heart was large towards God. And so it was that God said to Samuel, he's the one. How often and easily we use external things to evaluate ourselves with other people. We forget that God has an entirely different way of looking at them and at us. We may judge ourselves and each other by our net worth in comparison to someone else, by what we do in comparison to someone else, by our achievements or our degrees or our honors or our recognition, our kind of houses we live in, the car we drive, the job we have, the clothes we wear. What person in our high school group doesn't know what peer pressure is for their fashion, to wear the right label, to have the right name on the gym shoes? Why is it that we feel so much better about ourselves when we're driving a new car? None of y'all bought one this week, did you? I wasn't picking on you. Two cows were grazing in a pasture. Milk truck went by on the road in front of them, and on the side of the truck were these words, pasteurized, homogenized, standardized, vitamin A added. And one cow turned to the other and says, makes you feel kind of inadequate, doesn't it? You see, when we lose our focus and we get hung up on how we look, how we stack up next to somebody else, we lose ourselves. We end up like a chameleon, always changing and always drifting away from who God made us to be until we're no longer sure who we are. We forget what our true worth is, what our real gifts are intended for, what our place in the world is, that God, with his loving wisdom, has made for us and where he's placed us. This is why God removed Saul from the throne. Saul was so concerned to please the voices of the people that he could no longer obey the voice of God. Comparison is a trap, and it's a deadly game that too many people play. The road of comparing ourselves with other people, it is hard, it is unyielding, because no matter how we may strive or what we may achieve, there is always going to be somebody, guess what? Who is bigger? Who is brighter? who is faster? Or at least someone we think is bigger, better, and faster. And folks, at the end of the road of constantly comparing are some emotions that aren't healthy for us. Bitterness, resentment, and jealousy. Comparison robs us of contentment. Listen to how Steve Farrar, who was the founder of Point Man Ministries and one of the featured speakers at many of the Promise Keepers years ago, he said, our family moved from California where we had just a little tiny backyard and I had a push mower. Well, we moved to Little Rock, Arkansas, and suddenly I had a backyard that was a third of an acre. The first day I mowed that new yard was August. Temperature was 100 degrees and humidity 90%. When I was done, I had a sense of contentment. Our house was only about 10 years old. It had a fresh coat of paint. The lawn was now manicured and beautifully green. All looked awesome. I went in to get some iced tea and sit down and cool off, and I was flipping through a magazine my wife had there on the table just to relax, and I saw this article about a couple in Des Moines, Iowa, who had redone their kitchen. They had the before and the after pictures. The before, old stained countertops, now beautiful ceramic tile. Hardly any cupboard space to French doors with a rotating pantry. I flipped the page and there was another article about a couple in Boise who had redone their backyard deck. It was incredible. It followed the contour of the land and it had a really neat barbecue area. I had just run out of tea at that moment and I walked into our kitchen to get more. When I walked in, I stopped cold and looked at our kitchen. Old countertops. I went to the pantry to get some sweet and low. It didn't rotate. There weren't any French doors. Suddenly, I wasn't pleased with our kitchen. I thought, why do we live in a roach trap like this? I looked out at my deck, which I had just been enjoying all day, and I thought, I've seen firewood in better shape than that deck. And in about a 7-minute period, I went from contentment to discontent, all from looking at a magazine. I looked at better kitchens, I looked at better decks, and I was discontented with what I had. Howard Hendricks, an author and professor at Dallas Seminary for many years, said, "Comparison is the favorite indoor sport of Christians. Whether I compare my ministry, my house, my car, my kids to someone else's, it's just endless. There's always something better than what we have. Influenza used to kill people. Now we have to deal with affluenza. Comparison kills contentment." You get a group of 3 or 4 pastors together, it will not be 2 minutes before one of them says, "How's your church doing?" And the one who probably said that is the one whose church is doing really, really good, and he's waiting for one of the other 3 to ask him how his church is doing. We play the comparison game, and it's not good for any of us. In professional sports, every year there are some superstars who think they aren't paid enough. They just inked a contract that was the biggest for their position the year before, but during the offseason, somebody else on another team who plays their same position inked one for $2 million more. They are now dissatisfied with their salaries, even though they make more money in 1 year than most of us will in a lifetime. Their discontent is based on what? Their ability? Their comparison to others. Each of them think they're the best at their position and they ought to have the largest and the biggest. Ecclesiastes, written by the wisest man who ever lived, chapter 4, verse 6, says this: "Better one handful of tranquility than 2 handfuls of toil and chasing after the wind." I wished I had time to unpack that for you. But if you go to a Hope group this week, Andy Stanley will unpack that verse for you. C.S. Lewis made this observation. Lewis said, "We say that people are proud of being rich or clever or good-looking, but they're not. What they're proud of is being richer, cleverer, more talented or better looking than others. If everyone else was equally the same, they wouldn't be proud, but they would strive to become richer, better, better. On the road of comparison, inner peace is always a mirage, because the truest peace comes through a growing contentment in how God has made us and where God has placed us and how God will use us. And though He does not leave us as we are, He loves us as we are. And He starts with us right where we are. Let me wrap this up. I want you to walk out of here with this key point firmly entrenched in your mind. And I want you thinking about it between now and next Sunday. Here's the key point. There is no win in comparison. Can you say that out loud with me? There is no win in comparison. Repeat a little louder. There is no win in comparison. Why? Because there's never a finish line. Why? Because there's never a sense of satisfaction. You're always looking to your right and to your left. There's always someone with a bigger and that makes you think there's something wrong with you. There's always somebody with less than you, and you begin to feel superior. And then you realize there must be something wrong with you because you feel better about being better than somebody who has less. You see, it's no win. So what we're going to look at next week is if we're not to compare ourselves with others, with situation, with circumstance, where does our value in life come from? If differences are not the yardstick, what is the yardstick? Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, it's easy for us to identify with Samuel and with Jesse. It's often easy for us to look at externals and make significant decisions that not only impact us, but impact our families, impact our church, impact others around us. Father, it's not that you don't enjoy tall people. It's not that you don't enjoy handsomely rugged men and exquisitely beautiful women. But God, a person's worth is not based upon any of those externals. What you want to get a hold of is our hearts. And so, Father, I hope during this week we consider seriously whether we live in the neighborhood of And if we do, I hope there'll be a willingness on our parts to do as Abraham did, and that is pick up all that is us and leave and go to a place that you have prepared and promised for us. And there we will find contentment, and there we will find purpose, and there we will find passion, and there we will know what our true worth is. And I pray when we discover where we are, that we will be open to your leadership to put us where you want us. That we will have an appropriate value system of knowing that our worth is not at our right or our left, but it's found in you, O Lord. We trust this to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. Have a good afternoon.